is the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And all these things shall be added unto you. Alleluia, alleluia.
Good morning, and I want to thank you, Niamh, for singing all those alleluias for us. And I want to thank you for joining us this morning, whether you're listening on 105.9 Bishop FM or watching on our YouTube channel. You're most welcome to Bishop Auckland Methodist Church for our worship today. And we are worshiping with lots of different things. I want to fit in as much as possible into this service. We have a little bit of MHA, that's Methodist Homes for the Aged. We have a little bit of World Missions. We have a little bit of animal rights. We have a little bit of green issues. We have a little bit of everything. And I'll tell you what I want, what I really, really want. Yes, I want a bit of... Yeah, I want a bit of Spice Girls in it. I'll tell you what I want. Yes, the Spice Girls are taking us back in time there. But we want to go further back in time to the prophet Hosea, who delivered God's message to the people. And Hosea spoke these words from God, who said, I want your constant love, not your animal sacrifices. I want your love. And God still wants our love this morning. This morning on MHA Sunday in the Methodist Connection, which is an opportunity to give thanks and celebrate the specialist care services across the UK. On the 11th of June, that's today, folk raise funds for the intergenerational work already happening in community groups and MHA homes and in the community. And we begin with a little bit of a video. MHA Sunday is a celebration of all we do to enable people to live life, to live later life well. And part of living later life well is being in community with folk of all ages. And I'm glad to be joined in church by some very young looking folk this morning. And they're chuckling away to themselves. But we're going to hear from Angela and MHA Communities West manager with a mixture of people, young and old, who are gathered in a church in London.
Most of our members are in their 80s. Most of our members don't have as much family support and they're just living at home alone. So our objective is really to give them connection in the community. I have a team of community coordinators who work with me to provide a social programme every day of the week. This is what we do on a Monday afternoon, bring young people and older people together.
Because of these activities, I feel I'm full of company, and that's what's making me feel happy and active.
Oh, it's been great. I like working with the youngsters.
Got grandchildren of my own as well, although they live quite a way away, so I don't see them all that often. So it's nice to be with youngsters again. Yeah, I love it.
We are all on our own after retiring. Children gone away, they have their own place, so we need someone like this community.
I learned that old people are actually really funny, and also dogs like belly scratches.
I like seeing other people's faces, and I like meeting new people, and also decorating and having fun.
Everybody here likes to make friends and be more compassionate to other people.
So it's really important for our students at Northwood College to get involved with MHA communities. It helps them build skills they wouldn't necessarily be able to build in the classroom. Things like developing that empathy, being able to communicate with people that they're not used to, not familiar with.
You can learn a lot from them. It's really fun.
I like meeting new people and gardening so we have more oxygen.
You're all equal and together. You're all one big community.
We definitely want everybody to feel welcome, irrespective of their faith, gender, sexuality, background. So we want to be inclusive.
I think the more intergenerational contact that you can have, the better, and each generation can learn from the others.
Thank you for all of you who give financially, for those who pray for the work, for those who support us by raising awareness and signposting people to the schemes, because we know it changes people's lives.
I tell you what I want, what I really, really want. And I tell you what a lot of Methodist people want. They want hymns on a Sunday service. So we're going to sing some hymns. And I want love songs. And this first hymn begins, "Oh, the love of my Lord is the essence of all that I love here on earth." And as we pour out our love to God and receive his love, let us learn to love one another of all ages and backgrounds. Let's sing.
Oh,
mercy as gentle as silence. We want that gentle mercy and love and compassion of God surrounding us. But for those listening on radio this morning, we won't be silent for too long, or you'll think we've gone asleep in our prayers. So we turn to God in our prayers with some words from MHA. We gather to worship in your holy name. Open our eyes to see you in our midst and in the faces of others. Open our ears to hear your voice through scripture and music. And open our hearts to the transforming power of your Holy Spirit. Remove the barriers that would separate us from all that you have for us. Forgive our negligence of all that you have created in nature and each other. Forgive our ignorance. Soften our hearts and use us as catalysts for your healing. God of all good gifts, we thank you and praise you. You bring wisdom, ability, strength, and courage to our lives. Enable us to use our gifts in service to you and to others, in all that we do and in all that we are. May your name be glorified. We pray this in the name of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, I'm going to test the congregation here on their wisdom this morning, and at home you can join in and play along as well. The instructions are, for any good table quiz, you need a group of clever folk. Get into pairs or groups, or knock on the next door neighbour's house, or stop the car and wave at somebody else and get them to join you listening to the car radio. And if you can find folk of different ages, that will probably help you answer the questions more easily. Each group is allowed to cheat in this quiz. If you have a smartphone, or if you're old-fashioned and you have the Encyclopedia Britannica sitting on the shelves beside you, that's allowed. We will allow you to look up answers and find answers, because this isn't a competition. So our first question, are you ready? Our starter for 10, is that it? Congratulations to Durham University in winning University Challenge. Maybe we need some of those students with us this morning. First question, and I'm waiting to see how many hands go up in the congregation. Could you make a sponge cake this morning without a recipe? And are the hands going up? We have a couple of hands going up. And there's somebody waving at me from the back enthusiastically. I'm looking forward to at least 3 sponge cakes this afternoon, and we'll test out and see if the answer is correct. You're not. It's making it without a recipe. There are some old hands here who have made so many sponge cakes they could make it in their sleep. Second question. I hope you're having sponge cake at home as well. Second question. How far is it from Dundee to Plymouth? There are puzzled looks in front of me. Lots of puzzled looks. 566 miles. Somebody's been on their smartphone, I think. We'll come back to the answers later on. And for those of you who might have been at school in the dim and distant past, as whenever I went to school and I had to learn my tables and that kind of thing, do you know your times tables? If so, what is 7 times 8?
56.
56 is an answer that comes to me immediately. Maybe this answer will be as quick. What's the tallest mountain in Sweden?
Pass.
All right, there's a pass on that one. We'll come back to that one later. Have you ever worn or carried a gas mask? And I know some listening at home, my mother used to talk about having a gas mask in a box and heading off to school during the war with that. And maybe some of you have. The younger generation, no, it's not the COVID mask that we had a couple of years ago. This is something different. And over these days, in America, in the United States and Canada, there are folk in cities that almost need gas masks for the forest fires that are burning and sending smoke down into those cities. How many followers does Billie Eilish have on Instagram? Who is Billie Eilish or Eilish? Have the vote guess who he is, she is, what they are, and what's Instagram, you might be asking. If you've got a younger person, they know the answers and they will come up with that one. There's no answers here from my congregation. Maybe they're of a different age group. Seventh question, can you fold a terry nappy?
No.
There is some nods, some shakes of heads, but yet there is some knowledge still. And if you're asking what a terry nappy is, go and talk to your grandmother and you'll find out what a terry nappy is. And the last question has disappeared from my list, but yeah, what age is MHA? What anniversary is MHA celebrating this year? Well, we'll come back and give you the answers if you remind me to tell you later in the service. But we started with a hymn about God's love, and we're going to sing another hymn. Come, let us sing of a wonderful love. Have to learn about Instagram and Swedish mountains for a quiz, but we need to learn of God's love also and the extent of God's love. And I'll tell you what I want, what I really, really want this morning is to go on a little bit of a world mission trip. World missions is really no longer about going out with the good news, thinking that we know everything and others don't know anything. It is rather about building global relationships and partnerships. Global relationships, the new name for Methodist World Missions, global relationships facilitates the enriching relationships between partner churches throughout the world and the church, the Methodist Church here in Britain. It is the sharing of stories, resources, it is enabling people to move in mission partnerships. And we will visit this morning, we will visit Ecuador, but with the flooding in Ukraine this week on our minds, we will also visit Pakistan. In Ukraine, the flooding is because of a whole dam, but in Pakistan, the flooding last year was because of monsoon floods, and we head off there now.
Last year, between June and October, monsoon flooding devastated huge areas of Pakistan. The heavier than usual rains linked to the effects of climate change resulted in the loss of 1,739 lives and billions of pounds worth of damage. The Methodist Church in Britain has a long-term ongoing relationship with the Church of Pakistan. In a response of solidarity, the work of the Diocese of Hyderabad was supported with £15,000 to assist the church in its relief work. Food, clothing and tents were all provided to people left in a terrible situation. We join in prayer, giving thanks for the work of the church in Pakistan and its leaders such as Bishop Colleen, John and the distribution team, Mr. Imran, Mr. Michael and Mr. Dilawar. This and other similar work of solidarity is only possible through your prayers and support of the world mission. As we seek to demonstrate God's love for all through our global Methodist community, please continue to pray for Pakistan and stand together with our partners around the world. A video by the Methodist Church Global Relationships.
As we think of those global relationships, we think of folk like Rachel who served in Pakistan and now is available in this country to speak about her experience for the many years she served in Pakistan. But there are other younger folk going out as mission partners. And from my home church, Melissa headed out to Ecuador. And we're going to listen to Melissa now and her story.
Hello, I'm Melissa Newell and I'm a mission partner here in Ecuador, working with young people and teaching English and working in discipleship with the church. Well, as a mission partner personally, I would say that God has just really showed me his faithfulness every day in my life, always just giving me and whatever I needed is for that day and giving me my daily bread as such. But what has really impacted my faith as well is seeing the faith of those who I'm working with and how they pray and how they pray believing that God is going to answer, how they pray asking for every small detail of their lives and just believing that God is going to answer and he does. I would say that whenever if God has called you, then God will provide you with everything you need. Both emotionally and also physically, and he will just guide you every step of the way.
Thank you, Melissa. Seeing the faith of those I'm working with, she said, from Northern Ireland but working in Ecuador. And next we'll hear from Lady, a local in Ecuador, about her faith and vitality and love of God.
What does Jesus mean to the Tchila Methodist indigenous community in Ecuador? Jesus in my life means so many things to me. Firstly, he means love. I've changed in so many ways. And I've gone through very difficult situations. But he's always been there to help me. Prayer is very important because it's my way of communicating with him. He represents transformation and family unity, which is very important to me. Love and family unity, that's what Jesus is to me. What does Jesus mean to you?
What does Jesus mean to you? Well, global relationships, those partnerships around the world also mean that we should act within this country. And part of our work is with JPIT, where churches come together. And a briefing from the Joint Public Issues team back in January says this: asylum has been a hot political topic in recent years. However, debates often seem to focus on refugees and asylum seekers as a problem to be managed or dealt with, and forget that at the heart of the matter are people, people on the move, who are often highly vulnerable. This briefing seeks to put the current debates in context and explore what a Christian response to those issues might look like, and the steps to be taken to build a fairer and more compassionate asylum system. So what does Christianity have to say? Well, Leviticus chapter 19 in the Old Testament says this: when a foreigner resides among you in your land, do not mistreat them. The foreigner residing among you must be treated as your native born. Love them as yourself. For you were foreigners in Egypt. The story of the people of God is full of experiences of journeying and of exile. Perhaps because of this, a deep ethic also developed about how travelers and foreigners were to be welcomed. The biblical instructions to love the stranger, respect the rights of foreigners, ensure the fair treatment of those at risk of oppression, and the reminder that you were once strangers in Egypt mean that migrant protection is the most repeated commandment in the Bible. Do you get that? The most repeated commandment is to love these folk who are moving from place to place. What does God want? He wants our love, and he wants us to love others. Let's hear now our first of our Bible readings from Hosea chapter 5 and verse 15. And we have Lorraine reading this for us.
Hosea verses 5.15 to 6.6. I will abandon my people until they have suffered enough for their sins and come looking for me. Perhaps in their suffering they will try to find me. The people say, let's return to the Lord. He has hurt us, but he will be sure to heal us. He has wounded us, but he will bandage our wounds, won't he? In 2 or 3 days he will revive us, and we will live in his presence. Let us try to know the Lord. He will come to us as surely as the day dawns, as surely as spring rains that water the earth. But the Lord says, Israel and Judah, what am I going to do with you? Your love for me disappears as quickly as morning mist. It is like dew that vanishes early in the day. That is why I have sent my prophets to you with my message of judgment and destruction. What I want from you is plain and clear. I want your constant love, not your animal sacrifices. I will rather have my people know me than burn offerings to me.
Thank you. I want your constant love, not animal sacrifices. It is so tempting to say that we love God, of course we love God, but then treat others, migrants, the poor, treat animals, treat the environment with no respect. And we say, oh, in the Bible, God wants all these animal sacrifices. No, he doesn't. He wants us to love. If we cannot love those around us, creation around us, the fragile and the vulnerable, even capturing, as I am called to do when my wife shouts, "There's a wasp in the study," and capturing it in a jam jar and a bit of card over the top and taking it gently to the back door and pushing it in a different direction and hoping it finds somebody else's house to enter next time. We are called to love all and everything, as we are called to love God, the creator of all. Our second reading, for we also love to find out more about God, is from Romans chapter 4 and verses 13 to 25. And I think Kate looks ready to come and read for us this morning.
God's promise is received through faith. When God promised Abraham and his descendants that the world would belong to him, he did so not because Abraham obeyed the law, but because he believed and was accepted as righteous by God. For if what God promises is to be given to those who obey the law, then faith means nothing, and God's promise is worthless. The law brings down God's anger, but where there is no law, there is no disobeying of the law. And so the promise was based on faith, in order that the promise should be guaranteed as God's free gift to all of Abraham's descendants, not just to those who obey the law, but also to those who believe as Abraham did. For Abraham is the spiritual father of us all. As the scripture says, "I have made you father of many nations." So the promise is good in the sight of God in whom Abraham believed. The God who brings the dead to life and whose command brings into being what did not exist. Abraham believed and hoped, even when there was no reason for hoping, and so became the father of many nations. Just as the scripture says, "Your descendants will be as many as the stars." He was then almost 100 years old, but his faith did not weaken when he thought of his body, which was already practically dead, or of the fact that Sarah could not have children. His faith did not leave him, and he did not doubt God's promise. His faith filled him with power, and he gave praise to God. He was absolutely sure that God would be able to do what he had promised. That is why Abraham, through faith, was accepted as righteous by God. The words, "he was accepted as righteous," were not written for him alone. They were written also for us who are to be accepted as righteous, who believe in him who raised Jesus our Lord from death. Because of our sins, he was handed over to die, and he was raised to life in order to put us right with God. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Yes, God wants us to be right with God, to love God, whatever age, whatever country or background that we come from, however sinful or corrupt we might be. And it was the sinful, the corrupt, and thus, yes, the rich, as well as the old, the sick, and the vulnerable, who came to Jesus, and who came to show kindness, and yes, ask for loving kindness in return. We turn to Matthew's gospel, and we hear about some of these encounters with Jesus as Kath reads for us now.
Jesus left that place, and as he walked along, he saw a tax collector named Matthew sitting in his office. He said to him, "Follow me." Matthew got up and followed him. While Jesus was having a meal in Matthew's house, many tax collectors and other outcasts came and joined Jesus and his disciples at the table. Some Pharisees saw this and asked his disciples, "Why does your teacher eat with such people?" Jesus heard them and answered, "People who are well do not need a doctor, but only those who are sick. Go and find out what is meant by the scripture that says, 'It is kindness that I want, not animal sacrifices.' I have not come to call respectable people, but outcasts." While Jesus was saying this, a Jewish official came to him, knelt down before him, and said, "My daughter has just died, but come and place your hands on her, and she will live." So Jesus got up and followed him, and his disciples went along with him. A woman who had suffered from severe bleeding for 12 years came up behind Jesus and touched the edge of his cloak. She said to herself, "If I only touch his cloak, I will get well." Jesus turned round and saw her and said, "Courage, my daughter, your faith has made you well." At that very moment, the woman became well. Then Jesus went into the official's house. When he saw the musicians for the funeral and the people all stirred up, he said, "Get out, everybody! The little girl is not dead, she is only sleeping." Then they all laughed at him. But as soon as the people had been put out, Jesus went into the girl's room and took hold of her hand, and she got up. The news about this spread all over that part of the country. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Kath, for reading that good news for us, that good news of the love of Jesus. And we sing again of love divine, all loves excelling.
Perfect love.
I'll tell you what I want, what I really, really want, God says. I want your constant love. I want your love, whoever you are. I want your love, God says, your ongoing, faithful love, your love for me morning, noon, and night. I want your love, even if you think you're too old and too past it and getting forgetful, even if you're like Abraham and Sarah in your old age and you think your traveling days are done. But God called Abraham, we heard in our New Testament reading, and he was a person of faith with Sarah, his wife, in their older years. God wants our love, our constant, faithful love, to go with him each and every day. Abraham and Sarah were travelers who moved around because of God's love and gave their love to God and set up altars and worshiped God wherever they went. And their people became a wandering, traveling race that often moved and always were called to love God wherever they were. And their descendants were called to enable others to worship God, who came in from different countries and backgrounds. All peoples from every nation were called to give that constant love to God our Father, the Creator of the world, to give that love to Jesus Christ, who came into this world to travel and walk beside us, to visit the homes of rich and poor alike, to meet each person where they were and ask nothing of them but love in return for all the love he gave to them. To worship the Holy Spirit that fills our lives, sometimes with spectacular gifts, but always is there to fill our lives with the love for others and the love for God himself. I'll tell you what I want, what I really, really want. I want your constant love. And Jesus picks up on that. What does this mean? What does God mean whenever he says he wants our constant love? He doesn't want our dry religion. He doesn't want our rituals, our procedures, even our great hymns that are taken out of context and don't have our hearts responding. God doesn't want our money or sacrifices or for us to build vast cathedrals in his name and ignore loving our neighbor in poverty around us. God wants our constant, ongoing love, whoever we are. And we mightn't have other things to give, but each one of us have love to give, a God of love who gives to us. We need not be in fear of God. We're not called to fear him. We're not called even to understand him. We can live in ignorance of what all God might mean. We mightn't understand the doctrine of the Trinity or every creed that is written. We are called simply to love. Don't dismiss God. Don't ridicule God. Don't ignore God. Let yourself this morning be open just simply to love God, to embrace God, to give him your heart, and to open your heart to his constant love for you, for his holding and embracing you. What God really, really wants, we see in the sending of Jesus into this world. Jesus who came and yes, taught and yes, healed the sick, but more than that, in his constant everyday action from morning to night, Jesus loved the people that were around him. He came and sat beside us, and he offered love. And in doing that, he invited us to respond in constant love for God. Part of living in constant love for God is being in that relationship with him, bringing him our concerns, bringing him what's on our heart in our prayers. And when I say we pray, can you please respond, your kingdom come? Let us pray. God of our salvation and hope of all the ends of the earth, we pray your kingdom come, that the world may know Jesus Christ as the Prince of Peace, that all those who work for peace and reconciliation may know your blessing, grace, and strength. We pray your kingdom come, that the church may be one in serving and proclaiming the gospel. For the Methodist Church and partner churches in Pakistan, Ecuador, and in each and every place, that it may nurture people in faith and serve all in need. We pray your kingdom come, that the church may welcome and support all whom you call to faith. Give us courage to proclaim the love of God for all people. Bless those who minister in your name. We pray your kingdom come, that all who serve the gospel may be kept in safety while your word accomplishes its purpose. Strengthen us to carry out your will in all we say and do. Strengthen our partnership with our sisters and brothers in the worldwide family of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. We pray, your kingdom come, that all who suffer may know the comfort and glory of Christ. For all who suffer the consequences of violence, poverty, and environmental disaster. And for all who work for relief and reconciliation, we pray, your kingdom come. And we say the Lord's Prayer together in the version or language that you or your church is familiar with. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Our final hymn is, Lord, your church on earth is seeking your renewal from above. Some quiz answers. Dundee to Plymouth, round about 550 miles. Depends which route you take, or whether you go walking or flying or however you get there. 7 times 8, yes, the clever folk here got 56 very quickly. The tallest mountain in Sweden is Kebnekaise, I think is how you call it, at 2,096 metres. And Billie Eilish, the last time I looked, had 108 million followers on Instagram. And if you followed her this morning, she has another one or two as you've joined. And MHA, well, it was founded in 1943, making the organisation 80 years old this year, about the same age of as many of the folk that it works with. I tell you what I want, what I really, really want. I want you to go in the love of God, to constantly love God, and come back next week to hear Ev Swinbank. And come to the church, to the Baptist church and the Methodist churches in about a fortnight's time on the 24th of June for the Green Fair. And you'll find out that, yes, the churches are not about animal sacrifices, but about constant love for this community and the environment in which God has placed us. Go in the blessings of love. Amen.
We come to you with no pretense, yet nourished by your grace. We come as people needing love within this time and place. We come to you with no pretense, yet nourished by
each succeed.